Thanks a lot for all the work of the organizer to organize this conference. And merci à Gilles d'avoir 60 ans pour me permettre de parler aujourd'hui. So I will speak in French for Gilles and in English for the scientific part. Okay. So, alors, pour, comment dirais-je, pour évoquer mes relations avec Gilles et ce qu'a été Gilles pour moi et ce qui constitue, donc je me permets de vous montrer donc une vieillerie donc qui remonte à un temps où Gilles était donc au CERMA à l'école des ponts. Donc vous voyez donc je peux pas faire comme ça, d'accord. Ah si, excuse me. Donc c'était autour des années 87, d'accord. Et donc Gilles, juste après sa thèse, a passé quelques années à l'école des ponts dans un laboratoire qui s'appelait le CERMA à l'époque. Donc, et vous voyez qu'à l'époque, on avait quelques illusions puisqu'on s'était permis d'écrire un préprint en français. Bon, ça n'a pas duré très longtemps puisque bon, cet article, il a fini par être publié en anglais. Et donc, une petite anecdote que je tiens d'ailleurs de Gilles, c'est que cet article a été publié dans une revue est-allemande juste avant la chute du mur de Berlin dans les années 89. Donc, alors, si on tire un peu sur les choses, on peut dire que Gilles a participé à la chute du mur de Berlin, si on exagère un peu. Alors, donc, vous voyez, à l'époque, donc, ce travail a été réalisé donc, dans l'école à laquelle j'appartiens, l'École nationale des ponts et chaussées, dans le cadre d'un laboratoire donc, qui s'appelait le CERMA. Et donc, on peut regarder cette époque lointaine et passée avec une certaine nostalgie. Hein, et donc, j'en garde évidemment un souvenir ému et j'espère que c'est aussi le cas de Gilles. Et donc, de cette époque, en fait, concernant Gilles, je retiens en fait sa volonté et sa détermination à obtenir des résultats mathématiques les plus fins possibles. Donc, comment dirais-je, une certaine agressivité scientifique qui l'a amené à avoir des résultats exceptionnels dans toute sa carrière. Ça, c'est le premier point. Le deuxième point, c'est les qualités humaines qu'il avait dans les relations personnelles et quelque part aussi qui se traduisaient dans sa générosité et sa patience à l'égard des étudiants. Donc, j'imagine qu'il a pu mettre ça en pratique quand il s'est occupé du master de finance à Paris 6, enfin à l'UPMC. Et donc, ça, c'est des choses qui me sont apparues très tôt dans sa carrière. Voilà, donc j'espère que Gilles garde un bon souvenir de son passage à l'École des Ponts. C'était le tout début de la carrière, j'ai l'impression que ça a un peu orienté le type de mathématiques qu'il fait. Mais ce dont je suis sûr, c'est que l'École des Ponts peut être fière d'avoir compté Gilles parmi ses membres et parmi ses chercheurs. Voilà. Donc j'en profite donc pour lui souhaiter un bon... Alors, 60e anniversaire, ce n'est peut-être pas tout à fait le cas parce que ça doit être 60 ans plus une année de Covid. Donc, je lui souhaite un bon 61e anniversaire, donc aujourd'hui. Voilà, donc je vais commencer la partie scientifique de mon exposé. Donc, ce que je vais faire, c'est que je vais parler, excuse me, in English. Excuse me. What I want to do is to explain how we can approximate efficiently a stochastic volatility interest rate model suited to insurance problem. So first I will explain the context of this problem, what is the insurance regulation context, and the main tools of this approximation, Gram-Charlier expansion, and the pitfall of Gram-Charlier expansion. Then I will explain in detail what is how our approximation is is constructed using especially Jacobi process. Okay, so what is the insurance regulation context? I have to say that this work is part of the thesis of Sofiane Meala, and also that this is a joint work with Milliman, especially Alexandre Boumezoued and Pierre-Edouard Heroux, which are researchers in this society dedicated to insurance problem. Okay, so what is the context of insurance regulation? So you need to compute some what is called solvency capital requirement. That is to say provision in order to have a solid perspective for the future. And when you do this, you need an interest rate model in order to construct this solvency capital requirement, among other things, because you have also to model all what is appearing in the portfolio of the company. But as insurance company use mainly interest rate value, the central problem is to model the interest rate. And so you construct an interest rate model and you compute the solvency capital requirement in order to limit and to ensure the rentability of the insurance company and also to compute provision for insurance products. And when you do this, there is a lot of regulation contract which apply to the rate model used, because you need to calibrate on the current interest rate. You also need to calibrate on liquid option prices. And you also have to adapt your model to what is called the ultimate forward rate. That is to say some kind of right at infinity, and all these constraints need to be taken into account, and this leads in fact to a very complex problem. These characteristics lead to a very complex problem, and in front of this you have to do very efficient computation price in order to calibrate your model, and these two characteristics are almost contradictory. So you have to find some kind of equilibrium between these two requirements. And very often, quite often, this contradiction is solved using Gram-Charlier expansion. I will explain what is a Gram-Charlier expansion a bit later. But there is a bad news, because classic volatility model, Eston-like and so on. In fact, I obviously have non-bounded volatility. And in this case, the Gram-Charlier development, in fact, diverge. So the aim of this talk is to describe a numerical method based on Gram-Charlier expansion in order to be efficient, but with sound convergent result. Okay, so we want to be able to have a convergence of the Gram-Charlier expansion. And the basic tool of our approximation is Jacobi process. I will say a few words on this later. And our main result will be to prove speed of convergence of the approximation of Eston-like process using Jacobi process. And we will see also a related estimate for the computation of option prices. Okay, so first I explain what is a Gram-Charlier expansion. Basically, it's a development near a Gaussian law. The important word is near. Okay, if you are not far from your Gaussian law, you will be able to have a convergent development, but if you are far, it will not work. Okay, so I explain this with a bit more details. Phi of x is the density of the standard Gaussian random variable, and capital Phi of x is the distribution function of phi. And now you consider a random variable on R. You denote by f of x its density of probability, the density of its probability law, and you denote by capital phi its distribution function. Okay, and you denote by Hn of x the Hermit polynomial, the well-known Hermit polynomial, which are given here. I don't give the exact formula, but most of you probably know this. And you compute some kind of scalar product of x with Hn with normalization in factorial n. This is denoted by Cn. And obviously, this quantity Cn is the expectation of this polynomial taken into capital X. So Cn can be computed using moment of X. And for a lot of models, affine or polynomial process, in fact, it's not a problem, or it's not a very difficult problem to compute the moment of X. I will explain this later. And so, this number Cn are available quite easily in order to construct the Gram-Charlier development. So when you have your Cn, you can define a formal Gram-Charlier development as is written here. I have put a tilde here because this formula is not always convergent. I give a few words later. So f tilde of x is a development of f on the Hn, but with the density phi, which appear here. This is the formal Gram-Charlier development. And you can also take the primitive of this equation, and you obtain this modulo a small computation with the Hermit polynomial. And so you have candidate F tilde and capital F tilde to approximate the density and the repartition function of F. Okay, so the problem is when does this candidate are the exact thing? So you have a quite old result by Kramer, 1928, which says that if F is continuous and if capital X has exponential moment, okay, the four is important here, then the F tilde exists, and at every point, F tilde is equal to F. So this is the standard condition in order to have a convergent Gram-Charlier expansion. So it's quite obvious that because the Gram-Charlier expansion depends only on moment, you need to have a law which is characterized by its moment. And so you are sure it will not work with log-normal law, excuse me. And so if you want to use a Gram-Charlier expansion, it's mandatory to use log price in some sense, at least for Black-Scholes model and so and that kind of model. When you see this theorem and you try to develop a Gaussian law with mean zero and variance sigma square, and what means this condition is that you must choose sigma square less than 2 if you want to have a convergent result. Okay, so it's not really interesting to do this because you are expanding a Gaussian law on other Gaussian law, but it's interesting to have this in mind. And obviously, you can also replace the reference law, which is here a Gaussian law with mean 0 and variance 1 by another Gaussian law with another variance. And the stability condition in this case is sigma square less than 2 sigma square r, where sigma square r is the standard deviation of the reference Gaussian. Okay. And as we will see later, the best numerical situation, if you want to approximate this, is to match the first two moments in order to improve the convergence. So now what we have to recall is this condition in order to have a convergent Gram-Charlier theory. Okay, I give just an example to see what happens when sigma is small and when sigma is large. Okay, here I have used Gaussian random variable, and I've changed the variance of the Gaussian random variable. So what you see is that when sigma is small, this is the case here, you have a convergent sequence. What you want to compute is the reference is a black curve, and you have a convergent sequence of density. Obviously, the approximation is not always positive because you use a polynomial. It's impossible to have a positive approximation, but it's nevertheless, it's convergent. This is for the case where sigma is equal to 0.2. But when you have sigma, which is slightly greater than the limit, square root of 2, then the Gram-Charlier theory diverge. This is what is exemplified here. You see, when the order increases, the Gram-Charlier theory diverge. It's a well-known phenomenon. Okay, so in our example, we are interested in a stochastic volatility model. So I give here a very simple example of what is a stochastic volatility model. So I take S to be a key square of order 4, excuse me. And my interest rate model is R equals square root of S times G, where G is a Gaussian random variable with mean zero and variance sigma square, independent of S. Okay, in this case, it's very easy to compute all what you want, the moment and so on. And you can see that the Gram-Charlier theory does not converge. Okay, here you have the first term of the Gram-Charlier series. So up to order 4, it's not too bad. And when the order increases, then you have the Gram-Charlier series diverge. You see the green one is the last one. So you see no convergence on this simple volatility example. Nevertheless, you have to see that for n equal 4, the approximation is not so bad. And it's used in practice in some paper. You do a Gram-Charlier expansion, and you take n equal 4. And this is done, for example, in this paper. Yes, it's here. And it can be useful in some example. Where am I? Okay, so good. Okay, so for n equals 4, the approximation is not so bad, but you don't have convergence. You can prove convergence because, as we will see later, the theory diverge. So how to be sure that you have a convergent series? A natural way to do this is to approximate the volatility by a bounded one. So you take a number m, you bound the volatility, and you choose an appropriate sigma r, the variance of the reference Gaussian variable in the Gram-Charlier theory. And if you want to have a convergent theory, you have to impose that m times sigma square is lower than 2 times sigma square r. And if you do this, you choose a good sigma r, and you take a suitable m, Then you have a convergent theory. This is what happened in this case. If you have chosen sigma r such that this equality is fulfilled. So what I will do now is to explain how we can do the same kind of thing on more complex model, and more specially on stochastic volatility interest rate model. Okay, so what is the standard interest rate model used in life insurance? Basically, it's a BGM model, Bryce Gatarek Musella model. Probably everybody knows. They are also called market model or BGM model. Okay. Then you had, in order to have a good fit on option and so on, you need to add a stochastic volatility. This has been done on the theoretical point of view in this paper by Wu and Zhang. And now, because of very low interest rate value, you need to add a shift in the model in order to take this the low interest rate value into account. This has been done in this paper by Joshi and Remonato, and also more recently by Devino and Hall in their paper. In order to be more precise, I give a simplified version of this model. You can see this as a Eston-like model on log price. Obviously, it's important to consider log price. As I have said before, if you want to have a Gram-Charlier convergence theory. Okay, so my model of reference is this one. I have a volatility. This is a standard volatility model, CIR model. And then I use this volatility to drive the log price. And the Brownian motion are correlated using rho of t. So you can think of s of t as the log of the swap price. And what I have to say is that I have talked about shift. And you can see the stochastic volatility here, but you cannot see the shift I have quoted before. But in fact, the shift is buried in the lambda and the rho. But if you want to have a shift in your model, it's possible, but you have to take the good lambda in this equation. So what I have to say is that W is a scalar Brownian motion. You have only one volatility which drives the model. And W star is independent of W, but is d-dimensional because in the Bryce-Gatarek-Musella model, you need to have a Brownian motion for every tenor. So W star is d-dimensional, lambda is a d-dimensional vector, and rho is a scalar correlation. And in order to have a good convergence result and to be realistic in your modelization, you impose that 2k theta is greater than epsilon square. And so you are sure you have Vt strictly positive for all t. It's a well-known result. So this is my reference model. And what I want to do is to compute option prices on ST using Gram-Charlier approximation. So first I begin by a general negative result. I consider essentially this model, but in fact a slightly generalized model. And what says this theorem is that if the volatility here is essentially not bounded, it is slightly more precise than what I have said, but basically it says that, then the Cramer condition, that is to say the fact that the exponential is the experience of the exponential is finite, is not verified whatever the value of the reference variance sigma r. So obviously I've forgotten to say this, u is supposed to be positive, and the what you see here is that in fact you need to bound the volatility in some way if we want to use the Gram-Charlier expansion. If you use a non-bounded volatility model, Gram-Charlier expansion will not work. Okay. So this theorem justifies this. And in fact, you need to approximate your unbounded volatility with a sequence of bounded volatility, which converge to this one. So how can we do this? So you can use Jacobi process. I remind what is a Jacobi process. You consider a solution of this equation. This is as in the CIR model, and here what you have, instead of square root of x, you have square root of x star minus xt time x star minus x star, xt minus x star. So what happens when you consider this equation? If you start between x nth star and x sub star, and if the drift at this point, x f star and x f star have the good sign, that is to say this condition, you have a unique strong solution which lives in x star, x f star and x sub star. Okay. And it's obvious that the process is not affine. A very good property of the CIR process is that the process is affine. But this process remains polynomial. That is to say, the infinitesimal generator of this process sends polynomial of degree less than p into polynomial of degree less than p. And this is true for every p. There are quite a lot of literature on the study of polynomial and especially application of polynomial process in finance. I have quoted some of them. Cushiero, Filipovic, Larson and Pulido. And the main advantage of this polynomial process is that the computation of the moment remain easy in some sense. Why? Because for polynomial process, the moment can be obtained using the exponential of a matrix. In fact, computing the exponential of the matrix is not so easy, but you can do this with good performance very often. And having a polynomial process and to be able to compute easily the moment of this process is a necessary property if we want to use Gram-Charlier series. So in fact, we will use this Jacobi process and its polynomial property in order to approximate the CIR model. Okay, so how can we approximate the CIR model? So we choose V star, V inf star, V sub star. We define Q of V like this. Okay. And how this approximation is constructed, what you want is that Q of V is positive, at least between V F star and V sub star, smaller than V. And this must be true for every V between V F star and V sub star. And it's quite obvious that if V star, V F star is equal zero and V sub star is equal plus infinity, that Q of V is equal to V. Okay. So this is an intuitive way to have an approximation of the CIR process using a Jacobi process. Now, if you define V as a solution of the CIR equation and VG as the solution of the Jacobi equation, what you think is that VG will converge to V when Vista will converge to zero and V infinity will converge to plus infinity. So now I will give a more precise result on this intuition. And this is what is done in the Sophian thesis. In fact, for strong convergence, I begin with by strong convergence result. For strong convergence result, you can take V star equals zero. Basically, this is what we want to do. And you can prove a convergence result with a speed of a strong convergence result with a speed of convergence. Not very good speed of convergence, but nevertheless a speed of convergence. And you can also do the same thing when V star V sub star is equal plus infinity. Okay. This is a variant of the same result. You can also put the supremum into the expectation and you lose simply a square root. Okay, all these results are probably or even certainly suboptimal because the technique to obtain this result is to use a Yamada function. You can see that kind of technique in the book of Alfonsi. And probably this result can be improved. And probably the result, the optimal result in C divided by V capital star in this case. Okay, this is what we have done for strong convergence. I am a little bit late. Okay, and for weak convergence, what happened is that weak convergence is already proved in a paper by Ackermann and Hall in 2017, but there is no speed of convergence. What is done in Sophian thesis is that that if f is regular and has a polynomial increase, and if v sub star is equal to zero, then you are able to estimate the difference between the expectation of the approximate process and the expectation of the process, and you obtain convergence in C divided by v star. The method of proof of this result is quite standard. You use the Tubaro-Tallet method, and you compare generator of Vt and V star J. Probably, this result can be extended to irregular function, but we have not done this. Okay. Now, what I have said is only on the approximation of this model by this one. And if you are interested in computing price on option on swap, you need to add the S. And so you have to consider the coupled model. And in order to have a polynomial model, you need or you can construct an approximation of the couple SV by SG VG. And what you have to do is to put here something which is a little bit bizarre, but it's the only way we have found in order to have a process which remains polynomial. Okay. And so the aim is to prove that this model converges to this one. So what is important in what I have said is that SG, VG is a polynomial process. So easy computation of moments are available. So you can construct a Gram-Charlier approximation. And this Gram-Charlier approximation will be convergent if you take sigma r large enough. Okay. And what remains to be done, this is done here, is to prove that SG approximates S. So up to now, what we have been able to prove is that if we fix V star, V inf star, excuse me, greater than zero, small but greater than zero, we are able to approximate the difference between the expectation of F of SG of T minus the expectation of F of S of T. That is to say convergence of this to this by some constant depending of V inf star divided by V substar. But unfortunately, what happened is that the C of zero is equal to plus infinity. So we don't have speed of convergence completely satisfactory in this case, because what we hope is that we would have here C divided by C V star, but we are able to prove this, and we hope that the result remains true when V star equals zero, but it's not completely sure. Okay, so maybe some numerical example, but because I am a bit late, I will stop here. Okay. Okay, this is a bibliography for people who are interested. I stop now.